Thank you, Guy. Thank you. And thank you, Crayon, for inviting me here. So Mr. Venkatraman sold Crayon to all of you guys very well. I'm not here to sell you. I'm here to buy from you. Literally, that was the topic that I was given, that, you know, what do you expect? When you're selling to CIOs, what's the CIO's expectation from you? But before that, I did a bit of my own research, and just to get some smiles on the faces, I want to share some observations. I went through the Crayon website, and there was this introductory video right up front, and it gave me some messages. One is that you can have an adventure with Crayon, right? Go up in the air, and then, you know, you jump from the aircraft. And Crayon is like this parachute which will give you a soft landing on the snow. Okay, and Crayon is also like, taking this lovely, lonely drive in the mountains, empty road, and then a drone shooting you. I hope that's how Crayon is to its partners, a nice parachute landing for all of you. Coming to linking it to what I want to tell you is that, there are many parachutes out there. So why would a customer choose you? I think that's what I'm here to speak on. So here is the topic of my presentation, which is what does a spouse want? Well, I can safely say initially it was what does a woman want, but I wanted to make it gender neutral, so I made it what does a spouse want. And I think nobody has the right answer, correct? And I think when you are dealing with your buyers, which is IT organization, which is CIOs, you probably many times have the same question, right? What do they want? So before I go on, let me give a quick introduction of myself, just to establish the credentials of why I'm authorized to speak on this. I have 25 years of experience. Started my career in Tata Motors. I'm a mechanical engineer, by the way, so don't ask me software questions. Spent about 7 years in the business. I used to repair excavators, and then I used to do some process transformation programs at the dealerships. And then I started a CRM program in Tata Motors. I actually learned technology firsthand, and a lot of what is not right with technology as well. That program became successful. It became world's largest automotive CRM program, and got me the CIO role in Tata Motors. That was in 2009. I worked as Tata Motors CIO till 2017 for about 8 years, in which I grew Tata Motors team from a mere 15 to about 120 people. I brought investments to IT, quite a lot of, almost grew the budgets about 2-3 times. Don't tell it to anybody in Tata Motors, they would say I overspent, okay? And I was able to, we were able to bring in a lot of new stuff like IoT, which is the telematics, cloud. We were one of the first adopters of AWS in manufacturing, and a lot of digital transformation mindset, including aligning the entire senior management through certain workshops. So I hope now I can speak on the topic. So let me, so we first have to understand the context here in terms of a buyer-seller relationship, okay? When you're going and selling to a customer, and I'm, for simplicity's sake, I'm saying it's a CIO, because this is the guy who signs finally on your EULA. Can you tell me who's who here? There are basically two guys in this photo, right? There's a lion and there's a zebra, okay? So who's the buyer, who's the seller? Zebra is the seller, okay? And obviously lion is the buyer, right? That's how you look at it, okay? So let me put it this way, okay? When somebody is buying your technology, it's probably the first and last time he or she is going to buy it in their life, right? Isn't it? I mean, you may always top up, grow, etc. But this is the first time in terms of, you know, engaging with what you're selling to him or her. This is the first and probably the last time that will happen, right? For you, you will be selling it whatever, maybe 15 times a month or 300 times a year, right? So if you look at this picture, the lion is the guy who's after his day's food. He'll probably kill 20 zebras in a month. If he's more hungry, maybe 30. But the zebra is the one who's going to either escape with his life or he's going to be the prey. What this means is that either the customer is going to succeed with what you do with him or he's going to fail, right? So I hope it makes it clear who's the seller, who's the buyer. Okay, let's move on. So I just jotted down some expectations from the session. Tell me whether there are any more expectations. How to connect with CIOs, how to interact with them in social media, how to build relationships, how to convince on value rather than compete on cost, and how to sidestep the various mindsets and buying patterns, behaviors which are available out there. Any other questions are, apart from these in terms of how to sell? Okay, let me try to address this, okay? So when I was looking at, you know, what do CIOs expect, one is that I could give you an average of, you know, all my whatever 17, 18 years of technology buying experience, right? I could tell you, you know, what's good. Then I looked at it differently. I said, you know, I don't want to talk about the good sales engagements that I had with my partners. I don't even want to look at even the star ones. I want to look at what were the phenomenal ones which still have leave an impression on my mind, okay? And there have been those. And I then picked up certain themes from those sales engagements, okay? Which I thought I'll share with you here, okay? So one of the biggest themes is that it's not about your product. It's not about the sales process that you use. It's not about the tools that you use, whether it's Salesforce or something else. It's actually about you. It's about how you, as somebody representing your organization, come across to the customer. Okay. Think of it, end of the day, somebody who's buying, he or she is putting his bets on you for you to make him successful, right? It's not about your organization. It's not about, you know, it's not about the parent organization whose product you're buying, okay? So I developed something I call it as a CACAD model, okay? At the center of it is generating customer advocacy. That's the first C. I'll come into each of the details, but to do that and why it is important, the first thing is, the first thing that you need to display is authenticity. That's the A. The next is connection with the customer. The third one is accountability, okay? That means owning it for the customer and making the customer, taking accountability for making him successful rather than making your quarter, okay? And last is looking at your own sales career in terms of decades and not in terms of quarters. So let me take you through how these come together, okay? The first thing is customer advocacy. So how do you think nowadays, if a customer has decided on buying something, how do you think he finalizes that decision? Any guesses? No, my fellow CIOs don't get me as a keynote speaker. Okay, so the answer is, and I think it's obvious when you're buying something. Okay, what do you do when you want to buy a refrigerator for yourself? You have now chosen between a Samsung blah, blah, blah model, Samsung 350 liter model and a LG 350 liter model and a Whirlpool 350 liter model. This is just the short list. What do you do next? Sorry? No, that you have done everything. Now you want to like go and buy. Okay, So this is what you do, okay? And when I say this, you will say, ah, yeah. You actually send out a message in a couple of WhatsApp groups saying that, guys, I have shortlisted these three models. What do you think is the best? Don't you do that? What do you think CIOs do when they buy a technology or when they want to decide on the partner? Exactly. And in a sort of more accentuated manner, because you know, you can get reviews about your refrigerators, okay, on the internet, on Mouthshut or various portals. You never get a feedback on the social media about, you know, a product or a partner, because nobody goes and writes about it. It's a B2B sale. So they over depend on the word of mouth that they hear from the network. You won't believe every other day. So I'm naturally part of CIO groups, and thankfully I'm no longer a CIO, but people haven't thrown me out of CIO groups yet. On the CIO groups, almost every other day, people are saying that, hey, you know, I have zeroed in on this. Who's the best partner? Okay, that's how the business gets closed nowadays. I mean, believe it or not, if you don't have a positive word of mouth from the customer, okay, you may take it to the last stage and lose it. If somebody says, no, I mean, you know, I didn't succeed with those guys. Those guys just sold and scooted, okay? So this is the most important, to generate customer advocacy. Today is the social world, WhatsApp world. Decisions will be taken without you knowing how they are taken, and they will typically be taken using feedback from the network. So this is of the utmost importance. This is what everything else I'm going to tell you about is going to actually feed into this. Okay, how to generate customer advocacy. Okay. The first one is authenticity. Okay. Authenticity is, you know, beyond a point, once you have done the selling, okay, which is the product features and, you know, my differentiators, etc., etc. I think when you're sitting in one-on-one with, you know, your customer, it may be CIO or his direct report or anybody in the organization, the biggest thing is be authentic. What that means is that if somebody asks you, hey, what are your product's weaknesses? Will you be able to tell it frankly? If you are able to tell it frankly, you are being authentic. Now, authentic doesn't mean you underplay your capabilities. Okay, authentic just means that you tell it what it is, and you tell how I am going to manage these weaknesses for you, right? So authenticity is absolutely important. I can give you one example of a phenomenal this thing. So CRM, I told you my route to CIO was through the CRM program that we did. And there was this account manager from Oracle who we were talking to, and we became friends. And then, you know, once he knew that we were talking to Siebel, this guy was like, guys, I'm not going to sell you Oracle. You are going to implement it at dealerships. You are going to, the kind of users that are going to use this are basically, you know, people on the ground who need a very, very responsive thing, very, very high UI quotient, and a very flexible system, etc. Oracle cannot give you that. Oracle is more for telecom and, you know, banks or whatever, right? I think you guys should go with Siebel. Would any one of you do that ever? No, right? So this is, I would say, the biggest test of authenticity, that if your product is not a fit for the customer, is not the right fit for customer, then do you have the guts to say that, boss, I'm not the right fit? Let me tell you, if you do that, okay, you may lose that sale, but you may generate far more customer advocacy, which is the biggest thing I told you initially, okay? So I'll come to the rest of the story later, but you know, that really increased our respect for him. And then we were actually going to him with many of other decisions. Okay. Because who do you go to when you want to take a decision? Somebody you can trust. And who will you trust more than somebody who has told you that, I don't want to sell my product to you because it's not a fit for you? this relationship that I developed then still continues. I mean, I have moved multiple roles. This guy has moved multiple roles, but I'll come to later how that feeds into the long term, okay? The second is the connection. Okay. This is like how much you empathize with the customer. I mean, how much do you know what challenges the customer is going to say? Are you looking at it as like, you know, I have this gap in my numbers, I need to make it for my incentive or whatever, bonus or whatever? Or are you looking at it as, hey, what problem is the customer going to solve with my technology? Okay. The more and more you understand what problems he's going to solve with your help, the more and more you will feel for him or her. Okay. And that's absolutely essential. The best account managers that I've had are not the guys, who have like tried all their best to basically reach out to me. These are the guys who have actually found some connections into the organization. They have, sat with, my direct reports of my direct reports, who have tried to understand the problem, who have tried to see how, what's the context, how does their technology fit into it? What problems can we solve? Do we have budgets or not? Should I engage now or not? Et cetera, et cetera. Okay. That means they do their research. And to sell, you definitely need, I would say some sales vectors. And the sales vector most of the time, in fact, just today, I got a message saying that, hey, we do this. I'm like, so what? I mean, the first question should be, boss, this is what I read about you. This is what I read about your organization. This is the challenges you're facing. This is what I know about you. So if you start your pitch, or if you start the conversation, is that this is what I know about you, okay? Can we discuss it with respect to what I bring to the table? I think that's the right way to start. Or probably the other way is to just listen. Most 95% of the salespeople who have come and met me, and I think this happens every day with all the CIOs, is like, they come and they say, sir, I represent so-and-so organization. These are the tools I have. I have this cloud, that cloud. I can give you this hyperscaler. I can give you that security. Okay, then so what? I mean, you're actually designed for disconnection, because everybody wants to talk about the customer also wants to talk about himself. Can you ask him, sir, what cloud do you use? What are the biggest challenges you have right now? Okay. What are your big plans for the cloud? So here is a very small nuance I want to give you. Do you guys know the difference between open questions and closed questions? I think they tell this to you in every sales training. Do you know the difference between open questions and closed questions? Okay. So closed questions are things that generate a single word answer. Okay. It's like, are you feeling all right? Yes or no? Right. So most questions which start with is, are, that kind of thing are actually closed questions. So, sir, do you need cloud? Yeah. Now what? Now you have to think about your next question. Okay. The open questions are which generate a long answer. Okay. How are you feeling today? It can't be yes or no, right? I'm feeling good. How are you feeling? Then the next question. Then that's a conversation starter. Or, sir, how do you look at cloud helping your organization? It's very, very different from, it's probably asking the same question, but generates a very different response as to, do you need a cloud, right? So there are ways to generate that connection. Open question is an important aspect of it. But most of the people, I mean, I'll give you another example. Has any one of you, before going to a customer, read its annual report? Do you know what the customer's strategy is? There's a three-page document people put out there in terms of the organization strategy, et cetera. Then there are some numbers and all of that. The best salespeople, the phenomenal salespeople that I have met, Tata Motors was a public company. they would always come prepared. They would basically try to gather information, including from general information from the annual report. That actually generates a great connection. It may not give you the sale, but it generates a connection. You come across as somebody who knows about the customer. And I think that's very important. Okay. I mean, there are other things also, like, you know, going through the profiles, you know, going through their tweets and their social media posts. There are lots of these conversation starters which help you get the, build the connection. Okay. But this is absolutely important. If your buyer, maybe a CIO or somebody reporting to him, if he doesn't feel that you're trying to connect, or you're trying to, you're interested in him rather than you're just interested in your sale, the connection doesn't happen, right? Okay. Next is accountability. So now this is again that lion and zebra, right? Are you really committed to the customer succeeding with it, with whatever you're selling him? Because once you have sold it, there's an implementation, right? And you're the sales guy. Right? So technically, I mean, you could do what this guy is doing here, right? Or what this guy is doing, what each one of them is doing here, you can do that. This guy is not doing well, that partner is not implementing it well. So the best salespeople that I've come across, okay, they go outside of their mandate, which is meeting the quarters number, and come to the rescue of the customer if the implementation is failing. Many a times, if the customer has a unique requirement, they actually, they go all out to engage with the with their organization to tailor it for the customer. I'll give you an example. We had implemented Office 365, that was way back in 2014, and we were seeing this internet traffic like growing day by day, okay? We had actually, you know, upgraded our bandwidth within a year, and the way it was growing, because we were working a lot on adoption, okay? So we were like motivating people to put their videos out there on SharePoint. We were, how am I doing on time? Is it okay if I go on? Okay. So, you know, we were basically motivating people to use OneDrive and, you know, motivating people to use Skype. All of this has a, you know, cost on the bandwidth, right? So I have a problem. Should I go slow on adoption and therefore have a better, I would say, you know, visibility on my bandwidth requirement, or do I keep promoting it, but I figure out a flexible, you know, bandwidth mechanism? End of the day, in the whole situation, your biggest bottleneck comes on your endpoint router, right? How much bandwidth it can handle. So I told my account manager from Tata Communications that, listen, you know, the way we are promoting it, and you are seeing my traffic pattern, right? I mean, it's like growing like almost like 20%. 30% quarter on quarter, and I know why it is growing, because I'm, you know, working on many adoption initiatives. Now this is going to grow like this, okay? Now we have to decide whether you put, you know, you put a particular equipment which you have to like change next year, or whether we want to build a pay-per-use kind of model where, you know, you put a high capacity equipment, let's say 500 Mbps router at each of my locations, but we basically figure out a way of billing it based on the usage, okay? So the benefit it will have is that, you know, we won't have to like change things often. There's nothing like that in the portfolio, okay? This account manager, and it's a she. So she basically understood the whole thing, and she really looked at, you know, our traffic graphs and everything, and she first got convinced herself. That's the connection part, okay? That what we need is really what we need. Then she went back and challenged the rest of the organization and their product guys and the billing guys. Billing in telecom is not easy, okay? It's complex. And she didn't basically, I would say, let it go till the time she got the entire organization to basically develop that model for us. And my proposition to her was that, listen, what problem I'm facing today, I'm an early adopter of Office 365, a lot of people are going to face this problem. And that's when, you know, if you do it for me, you will have this, you know, available for other customers as well. It took actually a few months. I mean, she lost that quarter sale. She probably lost the next quarter sale also. Okay. But eventually when she got it done, it was a completely new product offering. It was like, you know, much more surer visibility into your future revenues. And that's how she took the accountability. There are other examples where, you know, I had a project failing and, you know, I basically sent an SOS to the account manager who had basically sold and then, you know, I had not talked to him. But the moment I told him that, hey, I have a problem, this guy basically came down, analyzed everything, talked to the SI, talked to, you know, my team, understood the whole thing, and then went back into his organization and then basically pulled up everybody that what's happening. Okay. Now, this is not his job. This is not the job for he gets the incentive. But he did it for making the customer successful. Now, don't you think if you take that kind, these two cases I gave you, if you take that kind of accountability, if you are trying to approach a customer, you're not getting his time, you ask me, Jagdish, can you connect me? Can you get me a meeting with this CIO I'm trying to approach? Will I not agree? Or will I not support you? I will. Right? So now you see the link between accountability and customer advocacy, right? So I become your advocate if you do this. Okay? Now let's go to the last one, which is decades beyond quarters. So sales is a very interesting game. You know, you are basically meeting quarter by quarter. Okay, but while you are doing quarter by quarter, you are actually going to build a long career which is going to span across decades, right? So it's like, you know, you are running 100 meters every day, but you have to run a marathon of your career. So the only way to run a marathon of your career is when you start looking at your life, your months, your quarters beyond the quarters. And whatever I've told you before this, if you do all of that, that helps you build a long-term career, that helps you take a larger picture of, you know, where your career is going, or, you know, if you're a partner, you know, where you are going in terms of growing your business, okay, beyond meeting the next quarter. Okay. So you generate customer advocacy, be authentic, be accountable, okay, and generate the connection with your customers, and then you are building a career. You're building a long-term career. So, on this note, let me now fast forward that Oracle account manager story. Okay, so fast forward. This was 2002-03 when we were talking. And in 2007, this guy actually moved on, and he became the India head of a BPM product. Okay, and this guy came to me and said, Jagdish, this is what it is. Okay, these are the ways this can help you. He took me through the entire product, and he said, Jagdish, what you are trying to do? Okay, this is something that can accelerate you 30% if you bring this BPM layer on top of your CRM. Do you think I ran a process with him? No, come and do a POC. This guy was authentic, was accountable. This guy did a POC in 21 days. Okay, and we simply bought the technology. It was not in my plan. It was not in my roadmap. I made a small investment. I said, I'll buy a CPU from you of this, and we'll grow it. And you know, as we grow, we will probably buy more CPUs of licenses from you. Okay, and that technology actually became a core of you know, what we do in terms of customer engagement, in terms of, you know, like fast delivery and all of that. Okay, so 5 years later, okay, something that this guy did to be authentic, okay, and added on top of it the accountability that he took in terms of making me successful with a 21-day POC. I mean, it's basically they generated far more business, right? So that's what I mean by decades beyond quarters. You do something today, which is the right thing for the customer, which is the right thing to make the customer successful, that will help you years later. Okay. So that's my small 7-8 slide presentation. Thank you. These are my coordinates. I'm on Twitter, LinkedIn. I don't use Facebook much. And my email is there. My mobile number is there. And maybe if we have some time, we can do some Q&A. Any questions I can answer or? Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Crayon.